Good morning, friends. I am Vilas Parekh from Mahiko. I am here to congratulate founders of Botany for You platform, which gives an opportunity to students and young scientists to get acquainted with the new technologies and latest research. I thanks Botany for You to give me an opportunity to present an overview on crop improvement using genome editing technologies on this life science discussion forum. Today, I will talk on basics of genome editing technologies, its application in crop improvement, and the regulation involved around it. So today's lecture will be more of educative for the students. And for actual things to be done in the lab, probably we have to have another session. So for any crop improvement, you need genetic variations. So what is that? What is the genetic variations? It could be of natural type, natural variations in the germplasm, and genetic variations created by human interventions. Natural variations are the traditional source for the crop breeding since the introduction of agriculture before 13,000 years. And another type of genetic variations created by human interventions. Those are integration of traits from wild types and land races, radiation mutagenesis, chemical mutagenesis, transgenesis, and targeted mutagenesis. Today, I am going to talk on targeted mutagenesis. So what is targeted mutagenesis? It is nothing but the creation of mutations in the plant species using engineered nucleases and using the advanced knowledge of genomics of that species. The ENS, engineered nucleases, along with the specific short DNA or RNA sequences, creates mutations in a host genomic DNA in a sequence-specific manner. Those ENS are being used in a gene editing tools such as TALENs, ZF, and CRISPR to develop new traits in the crop. By using these ENS in these tools, we can create the mutations of insertion, deletion, substitution, reversion. And using these mutations, you can develop new traits. And the entire process is transgenic, but the product is non-transgenic. To go for targeted mutagenesis, you need to understand that this process is transgenic, but the product is non-transgenic. And since the product is non-transgenic, the commercialization of the gene-edited crops will have less regulatory hurdles compared to GM crop. So why process is transgenic and product is non-transgenic? I would elaborate a little bit. So for any targeted mutagenesis, first step is expression of these gene editing machineries in a plant. For that, you need to go for plant transformation or transient expression of these gene editing assemblies in the plant that creates the mutations in plants in first generation, T0 generation. And then we would look for the segregation of that mutations, desired mutations, and the machineries of these gene editing tools. So in T1 generation, T1, T2 generation, we'd look to select those plants with only desired mutation and should not have any transgene in it. And after that, we'd like to select clean gene edited event, and it should have desired phenotype or no off-target effect, no transgene or vector backbone, and mutation type should be preferably SDN1, because it will have lot of consequences if you do not have SDN1. You have to go for regulation, certain type of regulations. But here, with SDN1, regulations are minimal. And after that, you need to prepare whole regulatory dossier, proving all those things, and then submit it to IBSC Institutional Biosafety Committee. Then Institutional Biosafety Committee will give permissions to the to release the commercial crop. And this is the scenario in India, possible scenario in India. The DAB, as per draft guidelines, I'll elaborate these regulations in my end of the my talk. So first, innovating tools, today I'm going to talk on TALENs. So TALENs are nothing but a transcriptional activator like effector nucleases. So how these TALENs were designed, basically. So plant pathogenic bacteria called Xanthomonas has an ability to infect the plants and transfer its TAL effector molecule, TAL effector protein in the nucleus. And then upon going into nucleus, this TAL effector molecule bind to the regulatory element of sugar transporter gene. Upon activation of this sugar transporter gene, this sugar transporter genes helps this bacteria to proliferate in the plants and create the disease. This is how this TAL system works. So how it was designed? So TALENs is developed by fusion of DNA binding domain of TAL proteins and the cleavage domain of HOK1 endonuclease. The TAL repeats are arranged in tandem fashion. The individual TAL repeat of 33 to 35 base pair, 35 amino acid recognizes a single base in the DNA. The TAL specificity decided by two hypervariable residue or repeat variable dye residues, RDV, at 12th and 13th position of that repeat, position of amino acid position of that TAL repeat. And then what are those RDVs at 12 and 13? So arginine recognizes guanosine, arginine glycine recognizes thiamine, arginine isoleucine recognizes adenosine, histidine aspartic acid recognizes cytosine. And then to have a TAL, you need to have pair of TAL, left TAL and right TAL. The each TAL is fused with the HOK1 endonuclease. So you have to design in such a way TAL, left TAL, right TAL, around the target sequence. So about 8 to 15 base pair, you need to leave it between so that HOK1 endonuclease can go for dimerization and then give double stranded break in that target sequence. So after double stranded break, as the plant has natural ability to go for DNA repair, it will go for DNA repair with non-homologous end joining or homology derived repair. And during the process of this DNA repair, it creates the mutation. It inserts the mutations. The second genome editing tools that I would elaborate is zinc finger nuclease. So zinc finger nucleases are cysteine to histidine to zinc finger domain is among the most common types of DNA binding motif. Domain consists of approximately 30 amino acid in a conserved beta beta alpha configuration with zinc atom. Each zinc finger domain binds to three bases of target DNA. The computation of amino acid combination in ZFP helps to design the construct. And here also ZFP need to fuse with the HOK1 endonuclease to make gene editing machinery. So here we have left TAL and left ZFP and right DLF ZFP designed in a such a way. So it's flanking to the target sequence. HOK1 fused to the ZFP undergoes dimerization here also, same thing. Makes double stranded break within 5 to 7 bases between the zinc finger protein. Between the ZFPs. And it gives double stranded break. Once it gives double stranded breaks, so during the DNA repair with non-homologous end joining or homology derived repeat, again it creates the mutations. The process is same. The third one, genome editing tool, today we are going to talk on CRISPR-Cas. So what is CRISPR-Cas? CRISPR is nothing but a clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. CRISPR-Cas9 is a RNA protein recognition system. It is not the protein-protein recognition system. Protein DNA recognition. It is the RNA protein recognition system. Cas9 was isolated from Streptococcus pyogen. It is simplified RNA-mediated bacterial defense against the viruses and plasmid DNA. So how it was evolved? I'd like to elaborate a little bit more. So bacteria has the ability to develop immunity against the viruses. So first time when virus infect the bacteria, so bacteria makes the memory of that viral genome in its inside the genome. So second time when it infect it, so second time it infect it, it gives that memory gives advantage so that it can eliminate that virus or plasmid from the bacteria. And the four components are involved in it: Cas9, sgRNA, donor DNA, and host DNA. CRISPR-Cas9 sgRNA assembly recognizes target DNA with a protospacer adjacent motif called as NGG. So I'll elaborate a little bit. So for CRISPR, if you want to design any sgRNA, it need to be adjacent to the PAM site, protospacer adjacent motif. For Cas9, it is NGG. The Cas9 nuclease in association with sgRNA introduce a double stranded break or single strand nick 3 braces away from PAM site. Other variants of Cas protein have different PAM sites, the site of cleavage and the cleavage pattern that I will elaborate in the next subsequent slides. Here also mechanism is same. So Cas9 gives double stranded break in target DNA from 3 bases away from PAM site, and with non-homologous end joining or with SDR, it creates the mutations. Either indels, or if you supply the donor DNA while design a construct, then it can, you can create an, it can insert a new DNA on, in the DNA genome. So after that, we would like to discuss the variants of Cas9. It's not just one Cas9 in CRISPR technology. So those variants are, first variants is Cas12a, it's also called as CPF1. This RNA guided type 5 CRISPR system isolated from Prevotella and Francisella bacteria. It has TTN as a PAM site. CPF1 sgRNA assembly is much smaller compared to that Cas9. CPF1 has 42 nucleotide sgRNA assembly, while Cas9 has 92 nucleotide long sgRNA assembly. The advantage of this CPF1, it has high multiplexing capacity compared to Cas9. It induces sticky overhang of 5 bases at 18 to 23 bases away from PAM site. It is preferably used in SDR, gene knockout, and gene insertion or replacement. That is the advantage of CPF over the Cas9. Here again, exactly same mechanism. This CPF1 goes for double stranded break. During DNA repair process, blunt introduce mutations, and that mutations are heritable, and with that we can create new traits in the crop. Another variant is CRISPR base editor. Here you don't insert the mutation, it is just base substitution. In this base editor, deactivated nuclease is fused to the DNA deaminase to develop base editor. So nuclease activity of Cas9 is removed, and then it is fused with the either cytidine deaminase or adenine deaminase. So adenine deaminase convert GC into TA conversion. Adenine deaminase goes for AT to GC conversion. And using this base editor, you can go for more precise gene editing compared to other gene editors. So, for example, in therapeutics, if you have sickle cell anemia, which is happened just because of mutation of one base pair, if you can use this base editor, you can substitute that incorrect base with the right correct base and cure the sickle cell anemia. Similarly, in plant science, in crop science, we can develop by changing one base or substituting one base, we can develop non-functional protein or non-functional gene, or we can create herbicide tolerance. Several traits we can develop using these base editors. The third one is DNA-free gene editing. Why it is DNA-free? Here you don't have to integrate your DNA editing assembly into plant cells. So we have to purify Cas9 with the sgRNA and then introduce into plant using bombardment or PEG fusion. This RNP complex, sgRNA protein complex, nuclease complex, edits genomic DNA without integration into the genome. It does not require any antibiotic selection. And traits like herbicide tolerance can be developed relatively easy. The disadvantage of this technology is it is laborious, time consuming, less cost effective. So it is good for academic purpose, but when you go for practically, it is not that useful in developing traits. Another one is RNA editor. Here you are not going to edit DNA, but the RNA. So CRISPR Cas13a or Cas13b, those are two types of RNA editor. Cas13a cleave the RNA in a sequence specific manner, and it does not require any PAM site. That is another advantage of RNA editor. So you can design anywhere using this Cas13. And also it can be used in non-dividing cells also. And Cas13b, it does not cleave the DNA because this nuclease activity of Cas13b is removed. That is the reason. And then when it fused to the RNA adenosine deaminase, it just substitute adenine to the inosine. This can create point mutation in RNA, which could rescue known pathogenic allele or introduce a premature stop codon to render an RNA non-functional. So I was talking about off targets. So what are those off targets? Off targets means creation of mutations by CRISPR-Cas system in non-target or genomic region, called as off target effect. This can be avoided at the time of sgRNA design if the genomic knowledge of your species is known, the genome sequence of your species is known and it is well annotated. Probably while designing, you can avoid those sgRNAs which can use off targets and select those sgRNA with minimal off targets. And even if you don't get a proper sgRNA with minimal or no sgRNA, no off targets, should not be worried, because we can remove those off targets by 2-3 backcrosses into the non-edited genotype and make the gene edited even clean. We have started the genome editing work in our Mexico lab in 2016. The first proof of concept work we have done is a PDS gene editing in tomato using CRISPR-Cas9 system. This is very good candidate gene for students and beginner, because within a couple of months, maybe few months, you would come to know. You would come to know whether system is working or not. And it will help you to establish gene editing system, CRISPR system in your lab. So PDS is key enzyme of keratinase biosynthesis pathway, because and the keratinide protects chlorophyll from oxidative degradation. The non-functional PDS gene shows albino phenotype in the plant. So if you see that albino phenotype, probably you can see that, you can tell that my plant is edited, but it's not always the case, because I'll elaborate later. So sgRNAs were designed to edit exon 2, 4, 5 and of PDS gene. Mostly while designing sgRNA, we need to make sure that you are designing sgRNA in the beginning of the coding sequence. Because for knockout purpose, especially for knockout purpose, I would go to design sgRNA in the beginning of coding sequence, in the beginning exons. So we are designing all, and then what happens, the exon 2, also exon 5 work well, and we have used public domains Cas9 synthesis and cloned in binary vector along with sgRNA targeting PDS gene. The regenerated shoot showed albino phenotype that gave the hope that this PDS gene could have been mutated in the desired target sequence. So this was confirmed with mutation detection assays like T7 and DNA sequence analysis of chimeric albino shoots. With this sequence, we have confirmed that this albino phenotype, whatever we have obtained, it is because of non-functional PDS gene, and the mutation shows that it was non-functional. And this paper we have published in Indian Journal of Genetics. This is how we have to start gene editing in your lab. So gene edited traits, how it is useful for human benefits. So it could be farmer's benefit, commercial benefits, or consumer benefits as well. So for farmer's benefit, it can be yield, disease resistance, abiotic stress resistance, plant architecture, flowering time, fruit ripening, herbicide tolerance, resistance. And commercial benefits, male-female sterility for hybrid seed production, fruit processing trait, biomass. And consumer benefits could be reduced abundance of toxin, increased nutritional value, and reduced allergen. This is a beautiful work from Lipman Lab. What they have done, first, they have knocked out first gene SP, self-pruning gene, and then second, SP5 gene. So with knockout of SP gene, they could develop indeterminate tomato into determinate and increase the yield. And with second knockout of SP5G, they could develop from determinate to double determinate. Plant height was short, and then it gives early yield, early flowering, and it promotes day neutrality. With this, you can harvest the crop very early and increase the yield as well. And it does not have day dependency, daylight dependency. Another beautiful work from Lipman's lab. Here they have not altered the gene or mutated the gene. Here they have altered the promoter. And by alteration of promoter, they have slowed down the promoter and reduced the expression of that gene. The gene they have selected is CLAVATA3. With a single knockdown, they could slow down the gene, and with that, the gene is involved in the fruit morphology, CLAVATA3. So with that, they could increase the fruit size, and that is the benefit for farmers, and it gives better yield or better advantage for the fruit. Another benefit is the development of disease resistance in plant. So this was done by deletion of chunk of DNA from MLO gene of tomato that develops powdery mildew resistance in the tomato. This is called as allele deletion. It's not just a couple of bases, it's many bases at a time. This is another example of plant architecture development using double knockout. The max one BNA VAX1 gene knockout of two BNA max one gene homolog from rapeseeds would increase the yield of rapeseeds. This is also a nice piece of work. Here I was talking about herbicide tolerance. Here they have used base editors to change single amino acid. And this changing of single amino acid in the plant, single base pair especially, that change the amino acid as well. It gives herbicide tolerance to the rice plants. This is an example for development of human nutrition as well as processing. Lycopene is a good molecule for development of immunity in the human, as well as it is good component for required for tomato processing in the form of paste or puree. So what they have done, they have gone for single and double knockout in the carotenoid biosynthesis pathway. So genes downstream of lycopene, they have tried to knock out, and which helps them to accumulate more lycopene in the tomato fruits. This is another example of reduced toxin, consumer benefits. With single knockout in the vehicular invertase could increase cold storage and processing traits of tomato. Also, it reduced the acrylamide accumulation in the stored potato. So since the acrylamide accumulation is less, it is more safe for usage for the consumer. So many people in mostly in North America, they have gluten, North America as well as Europe, they have this gluten allergy. This gluten allergy is because of gluten in the wheat. So what these people have done, deletion of 35 alpha gliadin genes from the wheat using single gRNA that produce a low wheat with low gluten using CRISPR-Cas technology. This is another example for consumers' benefit with double knockout of FAD genes, which is again the genes in the downstream of fatty acid synthesis, which converts oleic acid into linoleic acid. So upon the mutation in the FAD genes, more accumulation of oleic acid happens, and that increases the content of oleic acid in the oil of soybean, and which is more healthy compared to the more having linoleic acid. These are the couple of crops. Those are in pipeline, or some of them are already had commercial nod, and some of them are in regulatory chain. Most of them are from US or Canada. In India, still the regulatory system is evolving, and then draft guidelines are out. Probably soon we'll get regulation established in India as well. So regulation, we'd like to talk regulation in gene editing crop. The site-directed nuclease, like SDNs, they are called in the regulatory language. Three type of mutations, SDN1, SDN2, and SDN3. When you don't use donor molecule and you just use sgRNA machinery for gene editing, with non-homologous end joining, it creates mutation in the DNA. It creates indel, it creates substitution, gene substitution, base substitution, and that type of mutation is called as SDN1. When you use exogenous DNA for gene editing along with gene editing machinery, So if the change is just one base pair or just few base pair bases in the DNA, then that is called as SDN1. But if you are inserting a piece of DNA, foreign DNA, then it is called as SDN3. And SDN2 and SDN3 needs external supply of donor DNA, while SDN1 does not need external supply of donor DNA. SDN1 creates substitution, insertion, and deletion type of mutations. This is again what I was talking about, possible regulatory scenario of gene editing crops. In most of the countries except Europe, SDN1 is considered as regular breeding product, and it does not require any regulations if there is no foreign DNA in the plant. And in India, as per draft guidelines, similar thing is mentioned, except that you have to go for regulation at IBSC level, right? At Institutional Biosafety Committee level. You don't have to go to RCGM or GAC. So at institutional level only, you can decide whether to go for regular commercialization or not. For SDN2, in most of the countries, it is case by case. And SDN3, it will be treated like GM crop. And other countries are evolving their policies for gene-edited crops. This is the book we have edited, and it will be coming in January in the market. Strategies and Potential for Crop Improvement Using CRISPR-Cas Genome Editing. This is a very good book, and this will have all kind of aspects covered for crop improvement using CRISPR-Cas genome editing. This is my group, genome editing lab in Mexico, and they are the one force behind our gene editing work. So with this, I would be happy to answer questions. Thank you.